Now we're streaming. All right, all right. I'm not seeing it yet, but we will get cracking. There we go. All right, cool. All right, so what we're going to do today, my friends, is I'm way behind on answering Q&As. I got a bunch of Q&As I need to get to, and man, whew, lots of people had emailed me. I want to get to some of these. I figured I'd just do a live stream. Live stream I enjoy doing. They're fun for me, and I get a lot out of it. It makes me feel good about myself, and so that's what matters most. So we're going to go into these Q&As here, so just bear with me a second. What's up, Nancy? Retired 2019. Right on. First thing I got to do is make sure I have the monetization turned on, so if YouTube decides to run ads, I can get paid. So just feel free to watch the ads. Hold on, Carl. You had sent me something today, Carl, and I forgot what it was. I just looked at the email you sent me just a few minutes ago. I forgot what it was, to be honest with you. Now I'm drawing a blank. And I said, oh, okay. I just can't remember. I had that in my thing, stuff, the things of stuff to read, but now I forgot. All right. So Bear, why can I just freaking do this here, man? Hey, Patty. Hey, what's going on? Patty J. I haven't seen you around these parts. So if you've been here and I haven't seen you, welcome aboard. You all can't change inflation in RC. Only I can in Right Capital. Only I can do that. And right now I got set at 2% for general inflation. One second. Stansberry Research. I'm not the biggest fan of Porter, actually. I don't know. I'm not negative on the guy. Hey, Brian. And you had sent me a video to watch my too, I think, right, Brian? Hey, John. There's two schools of thought here in retirement planning, folks. There are negative Nellies that are negative all the time. Peter Schiff, Porter. There's a guy I'm drawing a blank on anyway, and a couple other guys, and then just the world's always falling apart. The freaking bond guy, I forgot his name. Hey, right on, Kirk. Man, there's a guy I'm drawing a blank on who's just always Gary Schilling, I think is his name, Gary Schilling, and he's the one who said we could have a 40% decline in the market. I'm like, you've been saying that for years. Right on, Brian. Appreciate it. These guys are perpetually doomsdayers. And I'm not a perpetual doomsdayer, and I try not to be a perpetual Pollyannish, positive person either. I do think they charge a fair fee, John. You're not getting let me answer what I'm just finishing up on. So the reason I didn't read Porter stuff is that, my concern would be is that it's going to be negative stuff all the time. And at some point you just, it just bores me, all the negativity. There's some legitimacy, but these guys, the boy who cried wolf, I just can't take it. And then you got Peter Schiff. I was talking to a guy today, the guy's doing my fence, and he's like, Peter Schiff was on Joe Rogan, saying buy gold, buy gold, buy gold. And I just, I get that, but I don't think you buy gold because, the dollar is crashing. I mean, look, at the end of the day, the dollar is going to crash. We're going to a digital currency. There's it's inevitable to me. I don't know if that's going to be 3 years, 5 years. I think it's going to be sooner rather than later. 100% that there's going to be a digital currency and the dollar will go away. I don't know when that's going to be, how, when. I don't even know if it'll still be monetized in terms of U.S. dollars. I don't know. But so that's the thing. I try to say, okay, how do I square this circle? Like, I don't think it's the dollar is going to crash, but I also think we're going to a digital currency. So how do you square that circle? I don't know. That's a problem. There's no right answer here because we just don't know. But I'm more concerned now than I was 6 months ago. I'll tell you that right now, because if you would have told me right now that we'd have, crazy people, telling you that you're going to go to jail and beating you up if you don't have your mask on and yelling at little girls for not wearing the mask. And I would have thought that'd be crazy. And yet here we are, it's nuts. So I don't know. I don't know how that's going to shake out. That's why I think you gotta be prepared for all sides, man. All sides. which the number one thing you can do is just avoid debt. There's just no other way around that. I mean, debt will always be the issue that keeps you from you know, enjoying your life. Right on. Devaluation of dollar and crypto hedge protection. I don't know how crypto can be a hedge protection. I just don't know. Let's see. Thanks for your work. You got it, Kevin. Hey, right on, man. I enjoy it. So thank you for being here, man. So John says, is Vanguard Personal Advisory Service a fair fee? It's a fair fee. But at the end of the day, John, they're just going to put you in index funds. And I mean, I'm not sure that you need to pay them a fee to do that. I just don't think so. Now, what the Vanguard service will offer, which I think is actually the value added, is that you have people you can talk to on a regular basis if you want. If you want just someone to talk to, you call Vanguard and say, hey, this is what I'm thinking. What do you think? The drawback about these guys, I'm just trying to get on my thing here so I can see some of the questions I had coming in. The drawback about all that stuff, of course, is that if they're only going to peddle the company line. But, you know, I know people work there and they're legit financial planners, and why I'm not so sure if they can actually be, you know, giving you the unencumbered thought process that they have. I mean, everything's got to go through corporate and compliance and all this stuff. But, you know, they have some wide berth in which to try to help you off the ledge, essentially, if that's that's ultimately what it comes down to. Are you do you need Vanguard there to manage your money? No, you don't. Absolutely. Do you need Vanguard there to somebody you can talk to say, hey, look, I just want to make sure I'm not overlooking something. And I think they're absolutely appropriate for that. And for 35 basis points, I think it's absolutely a fair fee without question. But it's not for managing money because they're just going to put you in index funds. All right. So let's hold on just a second. All right. Let's click on that guy. I saw a Ellie. Ellie is a 51, self-employed. 25 hex of money is coming in monthly. Any suggestions on where to put it for growth? I mean, that's the problem is growth. What's going to grow? I mean, I'm assuming all your debt's paid off. Man, well, I can't do this. Hold on just a second, guys. If your debt's paid off, then I would actually just put in VTI. That's what I would do. I have no clue what your situation is, nothing at all, but you can't go wrong. Well, I say you can't go wrong with VTI because people say, you're giving a recommendation. I'm not giving a recommendation. I'm just saying at the end of the day, VTI, the Vanguard total stock index, I got that. I'm plugging away every 2 weeks. I'm plugging away into that, just plugging. And that's what my recommendation would forever be. As long as people have some cash on the side and they have their debt paid off without question. Now, I don't have that much cash on the side and I don't have my debt paid off. I mean, I have all my debt paid off other than my mortgage, but I don't have, I still got a big fat mortgage. And I don't have any cash. My cash account is literally, in terms of I say, my emergency fund is literally my VTI. I'm adding to it. And I'm comfortable because every time I add to it, a couple of months go by, I got another mortgage payment in there. The market goes down 30%. I lose a couple mortgage payments. But every time I'm adding to it, it's just building. You see what I'm saying? So the bills, and it can fall, but still well above where I started with. So for me, that's my emergency account. I can't say that's what you should do because that would violate financial planning 101, which is you need 3 to 6 months cash for expenses. Completely agree with that. I don't have any qualm with that at all, but just be advised. That's not what I do. I just have it all in VTI. I got, a couple $100 in my checking account, enough to, pay the bills and whatnot. And then, I put everything on a credit card. I pay the credit card at the end of the month. I just do it again and just flood. I funnel everything to VTI, and I'm 50 years old. You know what I'm saying? So I don't have any time to waste either. Now I do have some money in in my account, my IRAs already, but you got to be building it towards a growing. And I think that's, VTI is the way to go, but I don't know you. I don't know your situation. Remember, the markets fell 54% from October 2007 to March of 2009. I can't get this to monetize and save my life. All right, let's see here. Found out today that no RMD, even for inherited IRAs. Is that because of the Secure Act? I bet it probably is. Evening developer, right on. He says, it's an interesting take. He does a good analysis of why BCH, I'm not sure what that is better than gold. Is that Bitcoin? Is better than gold or other precious metals? I don't know, man. Not like I sounds like I'm discounting him. I kind of am, but that doesn't mean he's wrong. I don't know. The issue in that regard would be that we have a history of gold, you know, for thousands of years that had always had a value. We don't have a blockchain, or I guess that's what, is that BCH blockchain? We don't have a history of blockchain or crypto. We just don't. And so we'd have no clue what's going to be. And that's, that's a challenge to me. Gold squares the circle. If I have a Roth IRA with one company for more than 5 years and directly transfer it to another newly opened Roth with another company, can I then take out the original contributions tax-free? No, not tax-free. If you're not over 59 and a half, you got to be over 59 and a half. Just remember that. The answer to your question is if you had it, yes. The answer, if you're over 59 and a half unequivocally, without question, is tax-free. If you're under 59 and a half, it's not tax-free. Just keep that in mind. You can always take your contributions out, though, tax-free, without question, and penalty-free. You just can't take out any gains tax and penalty-free if you're under 59 and a half. Hope that makes sense. Contributions are always zeros for the taking. You don't even have to wait 5 years. Contributions you can take out tomorrow. You just can't touch your gains unless you're under 59 and a half. You can't touch your gains until you're over 59 and a half and the account's been open 5 years. Hope that makes sense. Scary times. It's scary in that, but it's not. It's scary in the context that people are scared of just a big fat nothing burger. Oh, you don't care about grandma. That's so freaking stupid, man. I get so sick of you don't care about grandma. And I get so sick. You think coronavirus, still get people who claim I said coronavirus is a hoax. Never once said that. I do care about grandma without question. You don't shut down the frigging economy and put all these people out of work with a 0.2% mortality rate. You just don't. This whole thing is freaking nuts. It's nuts. And it's not about people wanting to protect grandma. It's about people loving the idea of being virtue signaling and having some power to say, hey, you don't have a mask on. It's nuts. I'm watching people. They had some freaking primary today and they're outside of a schoolhouse waiting to vote 6 feet away with masks on. I'm like, this is freaking insane. And here's the thing that pisses me off. I didn't even want to go down this road today, but I'm going to. The idea, we have so much evidence of previous studies that said the masks don't help that much, if at all, or even that they could hurt because of oxygen, the reducing oxygen intake. We have all kinds of studies that have never been disputed, never been debated, all peer-reviewed, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, all of a sudden, all those studies are antiquated. Now the new studies say the masks are good, and people fall for this. It's insane. It's freaking insane. I'm sitting there thinking, we have people, peer-reviewed scientists, done the studies, done the research. There is absolutely no corroborating evidence that is consensus at all that says this is mandated. And yet everyone in their little fiefdoms are saying, we're going to make it so you can't go to a church, but you certainly can go to the casino. We're going to do this. You can go to Home Depot and touch all the goods and stuff, but you can't go to freaking mom and pop's freaking coffee shop. It's nuts. And no one's calling these people out. So all the previous research from 2019 even, which says masks don't do that much of anything and it can even hurt because it restricts oxygen inflow, all that stuff is fake. But all of a sudden now, and everyone's like, ah, yay, masks. It's crazy to me. It's crazy. And if you don't wear it, you're going to jail. It's insane. I'm sitting there thinking, we've done lost our minds. Ah. All right, so, I tell you, man, I have a sneaky suspicion November 4th is going to be very bad for the left. I really, really do. I have a look, and I'm telling you right now, I think at this stage, Trump won because anti-Hillary, and Trump's going to get reelected more because of Trump than it was in 2016. But a lot of it has to do with they see what's going on in Portland and Seattle and the crap. They're like, I don't know. Don't sign me up for that. And that's what I think is going to happen. I tell you, man, I hope Sniffy Joe there chooses his Karen Bass lady who loves Fidel, will win Florida. And man, please, Joe, do it, man. So you can choose Kamala. You can choose this lady, Karen Bass. You freaking idiots. You guys got to get off Twitter and look what the real world is. But if he chooses that stupid Karen Bass lady, man, Florida will go for the Trumpster. And Florida is always a battleground state for sure. Because the Cubans not too fond of people who praise old Fidel Castro. Colin Kaepernick, I have a sneaky suspicion he would not find much love in Miami, if you know what I'm saying. All my favorite financial advisors love God. Yeah, man. put 800,000 VTI asking for a friend. I don't know what your other position is. I don't know what debt you have there, my man. I don't know anything about you. I can't say that for sure. I can't say that. Let's just put it this way. I did a video the other day about these folks who, by hook or by crook, they had a significant portion of money in the Vanguard Index 500. And they were just busy, just traveled the world and work, and traveled the world and work, and they never paid any attention to it. And they had the equivalent of 80% in Vanguard S&P 500 and 20% in the stable value fund. Friggin' perfect, man. Now, that might not be perfect for you, but as like, they're like, we need help with our investments. We're worried. I was like, hell no, you guys are kicking butt and taking names. It's perfect. 20% stable value fund, 80% in the S&P 500. Sign me up. Perfect. Actually, it's funny. I got to say something. Have y'all ever heard of Oxygen Financial? Oh, my lands. These guys must be desperate of something. I get a call from these guys every day now. They're right here in Atlanta, but every day I get a call on my cell phone. They leave a voicemail saying, this is Joe Schmo from Oxygen Financial. We're just reaching out. We know, I think I signed up for something on their Facebook account like last year, and I never heard from these guys, and I know of them. But I was like, what is going on, man? Like every day I get a call from these people. So listen, my friends, if you are hiring a firm that has to solicit every day to call people, that's and I hung them up. I hung up on them the other day because it was I thought of somebody else, and I said, "This is Joe Schmo with Oxygen Financial." I said, "Click," but I mean, it's like if you are calling that much, that tells me that you are desperate, and I can smell desperation a mile away, just like women can smell a desperate man. I can smell desperate financial advisor. I'm just telling you right now, if you are being solicited where they're calling you and calling you and calling you, walk away. That there's something that's gone wrong there where they're desperate for some reason. And I tell you, just walk away, because that's not the way. People in demand don't need to make those calls time and time again, if that makes sense. I'm just telling you right now. I'm like sitting there thinking, how desperate are you guys down there? I mean, hell. I don't have enough money. I mean, I don't know what their client base is. $1 million is usually a start. Look, I don't have anything close to $1 million. I'll tell you that right now. So if they think I've got some $1 million, boy, oh boy. VTI is the Vanguard Total Stock Index. The total stock. Yeah, right on. Carl just said that. What do I think about Ameriprise? I used to love seeing Ameriprise statements come across my desk when I was competing with them. I used to love seeing them. Because they used to sell all those river source crap and annuities. I think Ameriprise did a better job financial planning than Vanguard, than the Schwabs of the world, who are pure investment firms. But the reason Ameriprise did was to get you to buy some of their insurance products, disability stuff. I can't remember the whole life, but variable annuity, long-term care. I think they did kind of like Thrivent. I used to love seeing Thrivent financial stuff come across my desk too, because I knew I could always take them out easy. And but I also knew that the people who engage with Thrivent and with Ameriprise got sold a lot of stuff. I know that for a fact, which was neither good nor bad, but it meant the people who came to me from Thrivent and Ameriprise were delegators that I either willing to listen to the advice of the financial advisor. And that's good, but it's also not good if they're going to sell you a bunch of, you know, high expense stuff. And anyways, I used to love seeing Ameriprise statements because, like, yep, I can take those out. And I knew what happened too, is that once they got sold, there would never be any active planning going forward. I used to know that. I mean, they do the plan on the front end just to sell them stuff. And then after that, it'd be done for. You'd never hear from them again. Now, with that said, there are some good financial advisors at Ameriprise. This is not all indict, and I don't want to indict the whole company. There are, I know some, and they're good financial advisors. But at the end of the day, I always got to say, if I saw an Ameriprise statement, I was like, yes. If I saw a Thrivent statement, I said, yes. Because I knew these people were good financial planning candidates, because Thrivent and Ameriprise did good financial planning to at least have the conversations that other guys who are just investment guys weren't doing. And so I enjoyed that because I knew I had a good opportunity to do financial planning. But I also knew I could take out the accounts. I knew that because it's just heavy on fees. And when you showed him the fees and you showed him the lack of value they got for the fees, you could see the light going off, like, why again am I paying all this? And then and that was easy to do. What's called an ACATCH, to transfer the money over. Yeah, I'm no, right on. Carl says you should look at Schwab instead of a Vanguard. Yes and no. I got no qualm with Schwab. I worked at Schwab. I worked at Vanguard, you know, many moons ago, in the last century. But my issue with Schwab is they got the big three. They got Fidelity, Schwab, and Vanguard. And you can't go wrong with any of them, frankly. But my concern with Schwab is that it's publicly traded. My concern with Fidelity is owned by the Johnson family. And my concern with Vanguard is that it's owned by the investors. Literally, I own some of Vanguard. You own some of Vanguard. Not as a publicly traded, but they are owned. Literally, the mutual funds are owned by us. And that just makes them more cognizant of the fees that you have to pay and the services they provide. So I don't have a qualm with Schwab. I've talked about Schwab Intelligent Portfolios a million times. I just my preference is Vanguard because it's literally owned by the firm, by the investors. And I like Bogle. I think Charles Schwab, you know, he revolutionized the brokerage trading industry for trading. Vanguard revolutionized the investor industry, not the trading industry, the investor industry. And I think that's, for me, that always makes Vanguard just head and shoulders above anybody else because Bogle. But I got no qualm with Schwab. Apparently, Carrie Schwab Pomegranate did a book a few years back that someone made mention to me that said they don't credit your Social Security until you're 21 in terms of the amount that would go into your average index monthly earnings. That's not true. I don't know why she would have said that, where she would have got that from. That's just weird to me. And then she said, after the age of 56, your benefits can't change. And that's simply not true either. And I haven't read the book. I'm just going on this guy's, what he told me. So it could be hearsay, but I said, that's not true either. I that's just weird to me. This is Schwab's daughter, by the way. And that bothers me because that's bad financial advice. And yet that is being published in a book and it's just, that's not good. And I wish if you're going to write about stuff, when Social Security in particular, you better freaking write about it correctly because that could affect people if they listen to that crap and that's bad. Blockchain. I just don't know that much about it. I just don't know, about blockchain, Carl. It's something of interest. I thought it'd be something of interest to me. I signed up for, someone had done a course on blockchain with crypto and all that. And I signed up for it. And it's still on my phone. I need to watch it one of these days. I just, to be honest, at this stage just bores me. And that's my fault. It's not anybody else's fault because I probably need to know, you know, because all the banks are going blockchain. We're going to a digital currency. I need to know. I haven't taken the time. And it hasn't piqued my interest yet. But I imagine sometime it will. Who's my man? Curtis Stone from the Urban Farmer, actually. He's going to do consulting for folks who want to, you know, buy land. And he's only taking gold, you know, PM, precious metals, or crypto. He's not taking cash anymore. And I thought that was pretty interesting. So, you know, so if you want to find it, and in fact, he's got a, let me see if I can't find his Liberty on the Land. Liberty on the Land. Hold on just a second, because this looks pretty interesting to me. Yeah, right here. So let me show you what this guy's doing, because all right. So here, I'm going to show you this right here is Liberty on the Land by my man, Curtis Stone, who I interviewed 2 years ago, almost 2.5 years ago now. And I haven't signed up for it yet, but he's going to do a course where it goes into Google Maps and Google Earth, which I have right here. And I don't know how to do it. It's kind of messing around before I go on his live stream, but he shows you like the land that you're looking to buy. Look, I don't want to be a farmer. That's not for me, but I do like the idea of buying some land for, you know, a bug out location for sure. And here's Maine. I did a video earlier today talking about the coming real estate opportunities in Northern New England, because the amount of people dying greatly exceeds the amount of people being born. And on top of that, net migration is certainly going out of those places rather than in. So anyway, I said, there's going to be some opportunity up here. And I said, I want to use Curtis Stone, what he's doing, to see. He was doing something where you could actually look at the sun and see how the sun was, you know, like the sun, the way the sun goes, you know, like if you're, you want to have a if you're going to use solar, for instance, you want to have facing south. You got to have the panels facing south. And ideally, they're not rooftop. Ideally, they're on the ground. And there's a lot going on with solar photovoltaic. That's not just put them on the house. And you certainly don't want to put them north facing. They got to be south facing. Ideally, they can, the rooftop ones are always the worst. But at the end of the day, this is stuff that's of interest to me in case you're trying to go off grid or have a supplementary source of electricity and even thermal solar, even if you don't want photovoltaic, but just thermal to heat your water and stuff. And I actually, big time, geothermal. Actually, it's funny. I was talking to two people the other day, one Maine, one in Minnesota, that they're using heat pumps. I said, heat pumps in those places? So now that's heat pump is they're going to have backup and wood stoves and whatnot and propane or natural gas. But I said, that's kind of cool. Heat pumps as a primary way to heat. And then you have backup in wood or some kind of gas or oil or something like that. But anyway, so he's using, Google Earth to kind of show you the land, the terrain, about how you can, kind of search for land that you might want to buy and see what the quality of the soil is, the sun, the clouds and all that. And I said, that's pretty cool. Anyway, so this is this guy, Liberty on the Land. I'm a big fan of Curtis. And I definitely say you should subscribe to him for sure. Just kind of follow what he's doing there because there's lots to go on. But he talks a lot about the block, or not the blockchain, but the crypto and the precious metals as well. It's pretty interesting, actually. So definitely check that out. And while we're at it, check out, hold on a sec. What did I do? Oh, let me go to, let me go here real quick. This would be another one for you liberty-minded folks that you should listen to, because this right here, these guys talk a lot about crypto, Carl. Let me show you. Hold on just a second. Oops. There we go. Hold on just a second, my friends. Yeah, right here. Right here. Where is it, man? Is it Goose on the Loose? That was Goose on the Loose. Goose on the Loose. Hold on just a second. And then where's that? That's weird. Hold on just a second. There we go. Okay, cool. Let me bring you guys. Let me show you what I'm talking about. Share screen. You guys, if you're interested, like in crypto and farming techniques and stuff, Goose on the Loose Unloose the Goose. That's what's called. Unloose the Goose. That's what you want. Unloose the Goose. That'd be a good YouTube channel to subscribe to. And the reason I say that is because they got a lot of different. Yeah, right here. Unloose the Goose. They got a lot of different folks who talk about all kinds of different things on homesteading, farming, gardening, crypto. And whatnot. And I'm a big fan of that stuff. I think it's good. I think there's a growing community of people now, especially right now with what's going on in the urban areas of people saying, this isn't what I bought when I bought my freaking condo in Buckhead. This isn't what I envisioned. And they might be thinking about other things. And in fact, it's interesting because Curtis, in his video he did today, he was talking about how, he's seeing a lot of the land being bought up, essentially sight unseen by people in the city. Now he's in Canada and he was saying that, is being bought up sight unseen by people who have never worked in a farm, never worked on a homestead or anything like that. And they buy it with a contingency on selling their urban condo. And he says, these people are having a hard time selling these condos in which to buy the land. And a lot of realtors, and he's in Canada, are sitting there thinking, man, we get all these pending offers, but they're all contingent on someone selling their house and, Toronto or something like that. And that, again, that shows there's opportunity for someone who has cash, but also it says what Curtis was saying. It's like, look, it might show that you might want to wait a little bit, you know, 5, 6, 7 months if that is you, because when these deals fall through, you might be able to go in there and buy stuff up for a song. I am not wanting to do a homestead. That's not, has no appeal to me at all, but I like the idea of having, you know, just a nice little lot of land, you know what I'm saying? Someplace out with some fruit trees, you know, a nice little garden, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, just 3 beds, 2 baths where my wife and I and the kids can go and just chill. That's very interesting to me. I can't afford it now, but I think by the time my youngest is out of high school, 8, 6, 7 years from now, I think there could be some good buys out there, and we'd, you know, downsize this puppy, hopefully. And then do something like that for sure. We'd downsize and we'd be able to hopefully split, you know, whatever we get out of this house and to buy, you know, a smaller up in Blue Ridge, Georgia or something like that and maintain a smaller place around here. I don't know, but that's kind of my thought for me, or even in Maine. Cause I always think about having some kind of a little retreat up in Maine, and my brother's up there right now. And, you know, just send me a picture of Boothbay Harbor and stuff. I said, oh my goodness. It just looks fantastic. So anyway, let's see here. We talked about that money on my retirement. Silver is overperforming gold. Advisor suggested a cash value life insurance policy. Any thoughts? Yeah. What's the point? I don't get, I mean, there's always gotta be a point between it. And I don't know how old you are, Ellie. If they're selling you as a cash value life insurance for tax-free income in retirement, you ever heard this? So who knows this band? Run to the hills, run for your life. You know that song right there? Run to the hills. That's what you got to do. Now, if you're young and you have surplus cash flow, a cash value life insurance doesn't bother me. If you're older, 50, and you don't have that much surplus cash flow, Josh, cash value life insurance is not right. It's bad. That's all there is to it, because you're buying a life insurance policy that is based on your age, which means it's going to be hell of expensive. No other way around that. And if you can't fund that puppy on the front end when you're young and healthy, and the life insurance itself isn't very expensive, it's not going to do any good. I would avoid that. I mean, there's a very limited number of people who can benefit from that stuff, and I don't know who you are, but I would tell you if you don't have significant positive cash flow and you're quite young, I wouldn't touch out of the 10-foot pole. No way. Kevin, 53 debt-free for years, Max Roth, 401k Roth and catch-up Roth, actually saving 62% of my net pay. My 0.2% mortality rate. Dude, just Seely. Hey, Seely's on here. I like Seely. She disagrees with me immensely, which is fun. She does it in a nice way, though. All right, Seely, you ready for this? All right, you ready for this now? Let me start with you. What do you think the mortality rate is on coronavirus? And I know this. Let me go down here. So, Seely, let me go down. Seely, I'm hoping you're still here. What do you? Now, no one. I don't want anyone to bash Seely or yell. I just want to know what you think the mortality rate on coronavirus is. And no, Iron Maiden, right? The trooper, if she's still here, because this is where we have to agree on where we're starting from this debate here. 0.2% is what I say. And I'll show you where I get that here in just a second. But I need to find where you get this. So hopefully you will answer that, because I would love to see that. All right, so hopefully she's still here. I like Seely. I like people who disagree and but don't act all crazy like some of these other guys who are just cut and paste warriors. It's okay to disagree. Just don't be a cut and paste warrior, and just, you know, have something intelligent to offer. I don't even care if it's intelligent, but just don't be a dick. It's like, why you gotta be a dick? Just, you know, you don't have to agree, but just like, it's weird to me why people. All right, so we'll come back and see if Seely has that. Hey, Mary K. Basso. All right, let's see. Hold on. Hey. I got off a meeting from our school district mandating my kids wear freaking masks. That's child abuse, man. That's child abuse. I'm sorry. That's freaking nuts. Hey, Tim. What's going on, big guy? That just pisses me off. Dr. Bergman, the chiropractor. Who's Dr. Bergman, the chiropractor? I don't know who that is. John Bergman or something like that? So what's going to happen with the second stimulus? Go to Joe Biden and his... have they made income restrictions on this again? Because I didn't get the first one because I made too much money last year. But what happens is if you want to stimulate the economy, you give it to people who aren't going to save. The whole thing is just nuts. The whole thing is just nuts. And this is my freaking issue with Trump. At one point, I was like, dude, you got to get rid of Fauci. Fauci's is a corrupt guy. He's not a good human being. He's not a good person. He's in it for himself. He's completely conflicted. He says one thing one day, the other thing the other day, and then he like discounts. In fact, I was watching that video on that black Nigerian doctor, I forgot her name, who everyone says, oh my goodness, she believes in demons. Oh, and I'm like, well, I hate to say it, but you know, if you're not Christian, right? And I tell you that Jesus literally died and rose again, you would think I'm crazy too, because that's what I believe. I truly believe that Jesus died, foresaw his death, and rose again from his death without question, because he's the Son of God, or he's the God. He's the Trinity, if that makes sense. Now, if you don't believe in that, you're going to think that's crazy. All right. Now, if I tell you 2 + 2 = 4, and you say, whoa, I can't believe that because you believe that a man rose from the dead, that doesn't make sense, does it? Now, you might question the legitimacy of my stating 2 + 2 = 4 and thus go research it more. Then you say, okay, well, he was right there, but you know that Jesus stuff, that's crazy. But you'd have to acknowledge I can be right, even if I believe in something that you find offensive or crazy talk. Just because this one lady has a different religious perspective than you doesn't mean everything about her is crazy. And the funny thing that was interesting to me, she was, when has Dr. Fauci ever had a stethoscope on a patient? When was the last time? I thought that was the biggest hit to Fauci. There was. Because if he's not dealing with real doctor, if he's not literally a practicing doctor, which he's certainly not, who's he getting his information from? The AMA? I don't know. But is he getting the information? Because remember, they had that guy in New York City. I forgot his name, that doc who's saying ventilators are killing people. They're killing people. And they took him off of YouTube. He got banned from the ER. And he was like this. And I'll never forget, I had a guy on here, purportedly a Republican right-wing guy. He's saying, we need more ventilators. He was freaking out. I remember he texted me. He said, we're not going to have enough ventilators. We're going to have 2 billion people die. He was freaking out. And it turns out ventilators are actually hurting people, if not killing them. Do you know that New York State alone has more deaths from the commie virus than all the southern states combined? All of them. And the reason we know that for sure is because what they did to the elderly in the nursing homes. Evil stuff there. Evil stuff. And yet that was based on science. Remember, they all said the science. In fact, I was watching the guy try to take down my man David Cullen from a Computing Forever. He's like, the science says this about masks. It literally does not. It doesn't say that. I mean, the science of the correct science might. But the science up to this magical point did not say that. You might refuse to acknowledge that. I'll even grant you the science is conflicted. I won't even say the science is completely right on my end and completely wrong on yours. I'll be happy to say it's conflicted. But the overwhelming evidence up until this one point was that the masks aren't going to help that much, if at all, and actually might hurt people. It does restrict oxygen. We know that for a fact. In fact, I'll share with you. We can look at this right here. If I still have it, let's see if I have it up here. Hold on just a second. I might have got rid of the, I guess I did. I don't have my article anymore on how mask restricts oxygen and actually hurts people. And then you can say, you know, for a fact, it does, because if you have asthma and other breathing issues, you're not required to wear a mask because they say that could be hurtful to you for sure. All right. So let's see what Celie says as she answered my question here. And I'm not trying to put you on the spot, Celie. Yeah, she probably logged off. That's too bad. I was hoping we could have a good dialogue on this. Too bad. Look, I can't blame her if she got off because she said, this guy Josh is crazy. But that's the drive-by stuff right there. I'm going to say some stuff, but I'm not going to back it up. And when I'm challenged on that, I don't know. I'm not going to say that, Celie. I don't know. But it would have been cool if she would have stayed on board to answer that question. There's a lady on CNN. Oh, CNN. There you go. I mean, CNN, who regrets voting for Trump because Trump is making her go back to school as a special education teacher. Has actually Trump mandated that each county schools go back to work? I don't think so. I heard that Dave Ramsey clip too. And then CNN, I mean, who cares? Can one transfer funds from a 401k then immediately convert to a Roth? Absolutely. Absolutely, Hans. In fact, you can do it. You can bypass the IRA outright. Just convert it directly to a Roth without question. Just remember you're paying tax on the entirety of that income for sure. The coronavirus fear has gotten worse. I know, man. It's crazy. It's getting worse. It's getting worse as the cases are dropping like a brick in water. It's nuts. And now it isn't, remember exponential, remember flattening the curve. It's frightening to me that people are like, we got to avoid the virus. I'm like, why? Why do you have to avoid the virus? I don't get it. Someone was telling my wife on Facebook that you kill the virus by wearing a mask. You literally kill it. It dies, like it hits the mask, boing, like a mosquito bug thing. It's like, this is freaking insane. People have gone insane. You kill the virus by wearing a mask. And thus, if you don't wear a mask, you don't kill the virus. That's weird. And then I'm sitting there thinking. this is what people are going to. Now we got people saying, I'll get it, I'll die. I'm like, dude, if you get the virus, you're not going to die. There are a select group of people who are at risk. Thus, we need to work on building their immune systems, for heaven's sake. I mean, everybody should know this. It is weird. It's weird to me. Well, you don't know anyone who died from the virus. Hate to say it, but then I can always argue, you don't know anyone who died from this. You don't know anyone who died. We can play this you don't know anyone game until we're blue in the face. It's nuts. You don't know anyone who died in a car crash. You don't know anyone who died from a heroin overdose. You don't know anyone who died from peanut allergies when they're just going to school and they're just having to catch the freaking penis and had an anaphylaxis shock and died in class. Because the freaking teacher allowed peanuts in the class, which you should not do. But hey, we don't want to shut down the whole. We don't want to violate people's rights to have a peanut butter sandwich or what it was, a pass out. I can't remember what it was. We don't want to violate people's rights for that, even though we have a kid here who has to be in this class. He has to. He cannot not be in this class. And thus, if the teacher says it's okay to have peanuts in the class, that kid cannot leave, even though those peanuts could literally kill him. Which they do. Anaphylactic shock. Right. But now when it comes to masks, the whole thing is just corrupted. And we know for a fact, I was reading today, did you see this about the big pharma? Man, what was it? Something about big pharma got huge, is making big money off the federal government with the virus stuff. Let's see if I can't find it. Maybe I can't anymore. I just had a chuckle at the big pharma making big bucks. Oh, by the way, did you see my thing on Clorox? Clorox is up 45% since I did my video up back in January. My wife's sister, who is a nurse and works in a facility in a southern state, her doc was saying that she works with, was saying he was buying $11,000 of a Clorox stock because of this was the beginning of the coronavirus. And there, back then, Clorox stock was trading at 150 or something like that when I did the video on it. Now it's trading like 260 or 250 or something like that. It's gone up 45%. Just kind of funny. And anyway, the interesting thing is, it's something I'll just share this with something else too. For all those who say getting a college degree equals big money, she tells me, let's just put it this way, she works with people who are in a bad way, if that makes sense. And a lot, she's in charge of the staff for who work with people who are in a bad way. And a lot of the people who are wiping butts, changing diapers and stuff, have psychology degrees from college, making $35,000-$45,000 a year wiping butts. And I said, there you go. And that doesn't, no, that's just an exception. But I would actually say that's a rule. I'd say the exception to the rule of people making big money in college is doctors, you know, highfalutin engineers and stuff. But I would bet if you took a gander, especially liberal arts degrees, I would bet to say the majority, if not the vast majority, are not making enough to justify the amount of debt they took. I could almost go, I'd be happy to go on record and predict that for sure. Can't guarantee you that, but here we got people with psychology degrees. They know all about Freud, I'm sure. What's that Carl Jung guy or whatever his name is, but they're wiping butts in hospitals and nursing homes and making $35,000 to $45,000 a year. And that's a taxing job, by the way. Thankfully, they got that college degree. If COVID Relief Act goes through and the trust, I don't even know what the Trust Act is, so I can't comment. Has anyone ever dealt with Northwestern Mutual? Yeah, they're good. I'm a fan of Northwestern Mutual. I think from the life insurance perspective, they do probably better than almost anybody. But again, all those insurance guys are there to sell you a bucket of stuff: disability, long-term care, life insurance, whole life, the whole thing. And then they have asset management as well, and I think even variable annuities. I a lot of stuff you don't need, man. You just don't. And look, I have whole life, not on me, but I have two whole life policies on my kids each. So I have 8 whole life policies. All of our 50,000, 20 year paid up. That means when I've been paying for 20 years, the policies are completely paid up. We'll not have to pay another dime in premiums. And forever, they'll have 50,000, probably more, because with whole life policies, what happens, there's a corridor that once you get enough cash value build up, yet to keep it as a life insurance approved contract with the IRS, the death benefit must grow. So as the cash value grows, the death benefit has to grow to keep this corridor between the two. And that's one of the benefits of taking whole life when you're young and can really fund that puppy well, because when you take it when you're older and the cash flow is just too expensive, and especially if your cash flow is tight. Whole life, I'm just telling you right now, and then universal life is even worse. But whole life is, I'm fond of it. Universal life, again, it can work if you're young and you have positive cash flow. I got no qualm with that. But if you're not young and don't have that much positive cash flow, I just say stay away from it. And Northwestern is going to sell you a bunch of that. And they'll show you all these trajectories and how it could work. And they're just wrong, man. I'm telling you, I've been in this business so damn long. I've seen so many universal life policies that are about to blow up in people's faces that they have no clue. That's universal. Whole life is a little bit different, because if you pay their premium as they tell you to, that will literally be there for your whole life. You know that for a fact. There's no muss, no fuss. Universal life is different. Universal life, you got flexible premiums, there's flexible interest rates and all that. But whole life, you know what you see, what you see is what you get. But universal life potentially can give you higher returns, because theoretically you could get higher rates of interest than whole life. I say stay away. If you're going to relocate to have more bonds, would you do that in your taxable account first and get more aggressive with Roth to get more? If I was going to reallocate to have more bonds, would I do that in my taxable account? Now you say Roth/IRA. You always want bonds in your IRA. So Carl, I just don't remember. But if you have an IRA, that's where the bond should be. No bonds on a Roth. Ideally, you have no bonds in a taxable account. But if all you have is a taxable account and a Roth, which is probably not the case, then I guess you'd want your bonds in the taxable account, because you're not paying much interest now. But that hurts me to even say. If you have an IRA, that's where your bond should be. Yeah, real red flag. If you're getting a continuous calls on people managing your money, nope. They tested me 2 weeks ago being in a hospital policy negative. A nurse claims she just pulled a swab out and put it in the bottle and came back positive. Now, how that could be? They tested me 2 weeks ago being as negative. Then the nurse claims she just pulled a swab out and put it in the bottle. It came out back. I hate the heat and humidity of the South. I'm looking to move to Bangor, Maine. Any thoughts on Bangor? Actually, I tell you what, Claude, Stephen King had a wonderful tweet, I thought, which says, I'm driving around Bangor and all these Trump signs are out there. Oh! I said, yes. I got a sneaky suspicion Maine might be the we'll see. We'll see if Susan Collins can pull it out. I'm not the biggest fan of Susan Collins. I tell you that right now. But she's certainly better than Cindy Pingree, whoever the hell's running for against her. But anyway, I'll take her over these other guys. But the fact that people up in Bangor, that Orono, Maine area, which is where the university is, are not shy of putting out their Trump signs, that's good. That tells me that, and the fact that Stephen King is all sanctimonious, like, oh my goodness, don't these people know? I'm like, yeah, that's good stuff. Ain't nothing better than a rich guy seeing just regular, freaking blood and guts Americans pissing them off. Nothing makes me happier. I love you. Hey. That's the thing about Maine, man. They're not conservative in the traditional way, but they're, but don't mess with their guns and don't. It's good. That made me happy. And I'm not on Twitter. I just saw that tweet off Twitchy. I follow twitchy.com. That tweet was on there. And that cracked me up. But I could see Susan Collins going down. Kind of Claire McCaskill went down in Minnesota, Missouri. But, Maine had Paula Page for, two terms. You know what I'm saying? And the first term, they said he got lucky. In the second term, they went against him, and Paula Page still won with a lot more votes than he did in the first. So it's hard to take out an incumbent. It really is. I would love to have term limits, but it's awful hard to take out an incumbent. And, my mom lived in Maine. Big Deb, Big Lib, has voted. She donated, I think, to Bernie and lives Elizabeth Warren. But she always liked Olympia Snow. Olympia Snow had good constituent services, and constituent services matters a lot, man. It does. That's what makes it hard to beat the incumbency, because you get all the letters from the current person saying they're here to help. And when you call, they're there to help for sure. So I imagine Susan Collins learned the Olympia Snow way of constituent services, and probably is going to be tough to beat her out for sure. I can see Maine in that first congressional district going red, which would be cool. So anyway, the thing about that, you got University of Maine up there, and any university town is gonna be freaking commie. But other than that, it's not libs. No way. Heat and humidity are killing me too, man. I tell you, whew. What do you think about Raymond James? My wife has an old account with those folks. Raymond James, the company in of itself, is irrelevant. It's really the person that she's worked with. It sounds like an old account, though, that probably is just kind of sitting there, almost an orphaned account. I'd probably just move that to Vanguard or something. Josh, you show the right capital a lot. Is there a way to is a personal capital from the same company? No, personal capital is not from the same company. I get a qualm with personal capital, but it's not good on tax stuff. It's just not. I haven't looked at it for 2 years, so it might have changed. I highly suspect it hadn't. I charge $150 for a one-time fee for Right Capital. I offer no personalized help on that. You're on your own, but I do lots of videos on it. Right Capital has a YouTube channel, and you don't own it. You don't own it. You only have it as long as I continue to pay Right Capital, and I love Right Capital. I tell you right now, it's fantastic. So with that said, if I find out that they donate to Marxist rabble rousers, I will drop them like a freaking brick, but I highly suspect they won't do that. Good evening, Tennessee. Right on. There's a good doc from Tennessee. Yep, right on, Carl. Much obliged. Mary Giles says, could she have transposed the numbers? I thought 65 was 65, not 56. I must have missed something. All these new things that everyone expects to be big never are. Yeah. Yeah, if you buy the, if you get the right capital stuff, I definitely could see your numbers, and I will call you every day saying, "Hey, man, I got the new fangled thing." I the last thing I want to do is look at someone's accounts in here and say, "Hey, yes, I could see your numbers. That's a fact." $2 retirement government TSP. How would you handle it? Keep G for safe and keep C for the, and S for the market. Yep, 100% right, Michael. G for the safe and C and S for the market. 20% G, 40-40-20. That's what I would do. I don't know you, so don't take this as a recommendation. 20% G, 40-40 C and S. Kaboom, man. You're freaking golden, in my opinion. Mary Hampton, everyone's favorite realtor from Westport, Connecticut, is online. The reason Mary is late to the party because all these people are moving from New York City to get the hell out of Dodge and move into beautiful Connecticut. Don't waste good money on a heat pump up there. No, man, right on. My mother wanted funds for our daughter to fix up her house and moving. My brothers are not giving me her plan. I don't have much income. My savings. We got my mother's house in Texas trying to rent it out. My family income is 74, but I have good retirement funds. Rochester Bruce in the house, the Amherst. The only time that the word incorrectly is spelled correctly is when it's spelled incorrectly. So there you go. So here's Tim T. Heat pumps north of the 38th parallel will need a booster coil in the dead of the winter. Oof. So my man Claude, I tell you, the heat and humidity is painful, but I will tell you, man, make sure you have two or three sources of heat, because there ain't nothing worse than going to a hello gorgeous. Oh yeah, here he is. Yay. Did you just come back from a walk? You're giving me coronavirus. There's nothing worse than going to a house that's colder than outside because your heat, your pipes froze and burst, and they don't have the money to pay the oil bill. And that's just me growing up in Maine, man. You go into the house that's colder than outside, which is quite frightening. It's scary, actually. So just remember that. Make sure you got your firewood stacked up like a crazy man, because you might need it if the heat coil goes dies in the dead of winter. What is the best place to estimate taxes on retirement income? Social Security, pension, and 401k. Yeah, well, you can go to, let's go to it. We go to Right Capital, or not Right Capital, go to my website here. We'll go to share, and we will go to get rid of this guy here. Boink. And we'll go, if I can move me over here, we'll go to my website at Heritage Wealth Planning. All right, there we go. No one wants to stay? Okay. All right. And what you do is you go to Tax Tools, Interactive Tax Tools, right there. And this will take you to go down to State Tax Tools, a smart asset tax calculator. It's freaking awesome. It's awesome. So definitely use that, man. And then you'll get this pop-up. I don't know why that shows up. But you can download my book on Roth IRAs right here for free as a PDF. You will be part of my newsletter subscription, and you can always unsubscribe if you want. And then you just click on where you're at and fill it out accordingly. It's a great tool. Great tool. Big fan. All right. Hold on a second. Boink. Big fan. Let's see here. I just thought it was interesting to take with the dollar devalued 20% since 2008. Yeah, no, but I mean, all right, but Carl, the dollar, they're trying to devalue it by 2% a year. I mean, that's, you know, it's funny. I hear people all the time say the dollar lost, 50% of its value from point A to point B. Well, who's the guy saying that? He's saying, that's the nature of what their Fed target rate for inflation is, 2%. So, I mean, they're trying to literally devalue it by 2% a year. That's just a fact. So, I don't find that in of itself to be all that frightening. I don't, because that's the way the game is played. In fact, even Milton Friedman said that. He said, if we can get a steady growth of inflation, that's not a bad thing. It's this, the, is a price and wage controls, which bring to hyperinflation like we saw in the 70s that kills everything. But a steady, a slow but steady, predictable inflationary tendency is not a bad thing. And I completely agree. We're printing more money, but I just look at Japan. I'm not trying to challenge you. I'm not debating that, we don't have inflation coming down the pike. I look at Japan. I say, well, everyone who says it's definitive or imminent, I say, well, how do you explain Japan? And they'll always have, well, their demographics are different. Not that much. They always say that they own more of their bonds. Not that much. They don't spend as much. As we get older, we don't spend as much either. That's the reason they don't spend as much, is because they're in a demographic time bomb, as we are slowly going into as well. So, and China's going into as well. I mean, just the fact is the world's getting older, and we have estimates now that say China will have 750 million of people when they in 2100. That's a demographic time bomb there. Japan's dead to rights. Spain, Italy, the U.S. at some point. I mean, all these countries are—they're just not growing. The acceleration of population growth is going down. So the population growth is going up, but the rate for which it's going is going down. And 70 years or so, it's the whole world's gonna be different than it is now. And as people get older, they just don't consume as much. And that's what we're seeing in Japan. We see that in America, and we'll see it in China. It's going to happen in the world all over, for sure, which is inherently non-inflationary. That's the thing. If you counter the inflation of a 2% federal funds or target rate for the Federal Reserve Board on inflation and an older population who consumes less, that doesn't concern me all that much with hyperinflation. What concerns me with hyperinflation is everywhere and always socialism. Price and wage controls, everywhere it's tried, it's inflationary. Everywhere it's tried, because it removes the pricing. We need to have prices to get a gauge of the true value of something. And the idiots on the left always say, you should not charge more than what it costs for you to build this calculator, which is insanely flipping stupid. That's just dumb. And they say, so that's like the value added tax, which I absolutely despise. I despise the VAT. All right, well, how do you add a value on what's in your brain? How do you add a value on how much you work? How do you add a value on intangibles? You can't. There's no way to value that. It's completely, the value is what someone's willing to pay for it. And when you go to socialism and you make that command control with price and wage controls, you are taking the ability of two people to engage in a transaction that suits both of them. It's insanely freaking, it treats us all as children that need government to tell us what to do and how to price stuff, which is, screw all that crap, man. So if Biden gets in, it's again, Sniffy Joe, he doesn't know who he is. He just wants to sniff little girls' hair. But if he gets in, he's going to have the biggest rabble-rouser radical group of people we've ever seen. And they're going to engage in price and wage controls like we have never seen. And even worse than Nixon, one of the worst presidents we ever had. And it's going to be ugly. And that will be inflationary. But just because the printing of the dollar, the dollar doesn't get consumed, is not going into the velocity of the money in terms of I spend it, you spend it, that guy spends it like that. It's just inherently non-inflationary, just not. And older people consume less, thus the velocity of money is reduced. I like watching uneducated economists. Yeah, man. My man over there, Simon. I tried to interview him. We're trading emails back and forth, but we haven't made it work yet. I'm trying to get him to interview. I'm trying to interview him on my channel. I'm a fan. I see a lot of Yankees coming down North Central Arkansas. Was that because the Ozark show? It makes them say, hey, Arkansas, that's where I want to be. Is that what they're saying? Lots of Great Lakes people. Okay, gotcha. I've been looking at Northeast Tennessee for another house, but the price has gone crazy. Yep. Yeah, I think that's too many people moving from out of state. Yep, 100% right. I think that's the word is out about Tennessee. That's a fact. And would I miss Tim Pool's on the same time? Hey, Homer. Never been to Maine. Oh, man. Dude. Damn. When you go to Maine, they'll say home of Josh Scanlon. I'm just just joking. Yep, Maine Senate race, a toss-up. Yep. You take my life, but I'll take yours too. Iron Maiden's right, man. I just started listening to this guy, Rageaholic. Oh my goodness. This guy is fantastic. If you he's got Metal Mythos, Black Sabbath, is what I'm listening to right now. This guy, I don't know if you ever heard of him, Rageaholic. I guess he calls himself the Razor. I don't know how I came across this guy, but this guy spins just the way he spins the words. Oh my, he's like a disc jockey who's just unencumbered. I'm like, what did he say? He said something about, oh my goodness, I'm sitting there. His anecdotes and metaphors are the funniest thing. Anyway, he's doing he does some stuff on, I don't like video games, but he does some stuff on like the most underrated albums of the 80s metal albums. And it's pretty cool. And then, you know, he did some Iron Maiden, Judas Priest, doing Black Sabbath, I'm listening to now, Motorhead. And I never got into King Diamond. He did some King Diamond. The Ramones. Motorhead never did anything for me. The Ramones never did anything for me. But after his take, I might have to jump into some Ramones. It sounds like I might have missed the boat there. They sound pretty good. I never got into them. He's done some good stuff there. The Rageaholic, highly recommend his channel. That stuff's fantastic. I mean, it's insanely good. This is insanely good stuff, is for sure. My man Chris is in Maine. I have a heat pump I only use in the summer for the air conditioning. Yep, oil and wood for heat. Right on, man. Yeah, my man Tom, I appreciate your emails, brother. I wasn't gonna say your name online, but it looks like you just did. But I was gonna do a video saying that. You know, talk about the giving me the accolades because I'm going to promote myself, but much obliged, Tom. You're a good man. I don't care what they say. He says, because of me, I was able to retire. Actually, it wasn't because of me, it's because of Tom. I didn't do all the work. You know, he did it. He just needed someone to confirm. I was able to do that. Drove to Blue Ridge this last Saturday and always enjoy the drive, eating barbecue and looking at the scenery. Right on, man. The annual U.S. death rate is 0.92, about 3 million die each year in the U.S. How dare you, Vinyl? How dare you? How dare you? 750 people die a day in the U.S. Yep, yep. So at the end of the year, we'll see if more than 3 million died this year. Could not agree more. And it's going to be magic. No one died from the flu this year. It'll be magic. Well, the flu, no one died from it. It's crazy. Case fatality, overall fatality you were talking about. Overall fatality. And what I mean, overall fatality, all right, well, I guess you could say that's case fatality. What I mean by that is a lot of these people saying 3-4% are using the only people that have actually tested positive, which we could challenge that too. On top of that, the people who have died from coronavirus, which we can challenge too, but I'm not even gonna do that. So we can say in reality, we know the people tested for positive is less than the number of people who they have died is less. But when you factor in what the CDC itself says, when you factor what Penn State itself said, when you factor what other folks have said, the Santa Clara study and many other studies, that the amount of people, even freaking Cuomo, even Killer Cuomo up there, the amount of people who had the commie virus weren't tested was a factor. CDC is at least 12 times that of what's been reported. All right, so you can immediately say if the CDC is reporting 3 million people are testing positive, well, 3 times 12, whatever that is, 36 million people, something like that. I mean, what, 12 times 3 is 36, right? Have it, just they don't test. Why don't they test? Because they don't feel any reason to. Have I had the coronavirus? I have no clue. I don't feel any reason to. Have you had the coronavirus? I have no clue. I don't go test it. Why? Because I don't feel any need to. It's that simple. You have the antibodies? I don't know. No one knows. That's the issue. If you don't get tested, you don't know if you have antibodies, you don't know. Another study recently came out, this kind of cracked me up too. They said basically the antibodies that you have or you could get might not be permanent, which would tell you that you could have a second wave, the deadly second wave. And I'm sitting there thinking, well, if that's the case in the vaccine, why are we even bothered? So if you say, look, if we had 150,000 people dead, and we know that Dr. Birx and many others have said we're way overestimating that. And Dr. Birx said 25%, so we'll say we'll take off, 37,500, so that gives 130,000, 125,000, something like that. 125,000 people, and you can say 20 million people have had it. That's a whole different ball game when it comes to case fatality rate, but it depends on what you're defining as case fatality rate. I got all my community tab, all these articles. I've linked to them all on the community tab of Heritage Wealth Planning, which shows you each one part and parcel of various studies, of various research that says CDC, Penn State, the guys outside of Ionopolis, I can't remember, from Stanford. So many people have said this time and again, and even old Killer Cuomo himself. Many more people have the virus that have been tested positive, and yet many more people have not died. So that's what we know. Bruce says 0.7. I don't even think it's that, Bruce. I think it's about 0.2. We can even maybe 0.3. And that's just of people who we could say. Now, if you look at the overall population as a whole, and I never liked what people did that at first when they say, well, my goodness, we have 100 deaths. We have, 330 million people in America. I never liked that because it didn't have enough time to actually, kind of work its way into society now. But now we can start using it if we want. We can say, look, we got, 150,000 people dead, 330 million people in America. The virus has been around since November. So essentially we're going 8-9 months. The vast majority of the time we were close contact. We were spreading it, people sneeze on each other and whatnot. And so by now we have a pretty good idea of the fatality rate when it comes to population as a whole. We have a pretty good gauge because we don't have the corpses lined up in the street. Remember when that fake stuff in Ecuador, look at all these corpses in the street, how quickly that kind of came and went, right? It's just the media loves scaring people to try to blame Trump. It's sad. It's crazy. Then of course, Fauci, did you see him with Jim Jordan the other day? He just could not say, that the Black Lives Matter protest, he just could not say that it's helping spread the virus, which again, I don't care because the more people get it, the more herd immunity, which again, all the pro-vaxxers used to say herd immunity. We want herd immunity. I don't know why we don't want it in this case. It's the weirdest thing to me. Now it's not herd immunity. Now we don't want to get it, but you can't stop it. It's like the old Twisted Sister song. You can't stop rock and roll. I say, you can't stop the commie virus. You can't. So because of that, you're going to get it or not, and you're going to get it. You're not going to die. And so let's just move on, get done with it, and move on with our lives. That's simple. But now that you got antibodies that say they could, they might not last, 2 to 3 months. So then what? Afraid a big dip of my 401k. You're retiring in 5 years. You want to sit out for 12 months? I can't, man, 5 years. You're still an intermediate term investor, man. So your process would be, I'm going to sit out for a year. And then I'm going to get back in because of what? So the market went up. You set out for a year. You missed that. Are you more inclined to get back in if the market's up? I don't think so. I think you'd be less inclined because where you are now would just be multiplied, right? You say, I think the market is due for a big dip. It's at 100 down. Now it's at 120 a year from now. You're probably going to sit out then too, right? All right. So the market stays flat. All right. Are you going to get back in if the market stays flat? No, you probably say because you're still waiting for that big dip. All right. So now the big dip comes. The big dip is what? 20%? Are you getting back in at 20? Or are you going to wait till it goes 30 or 40? I mean, that's the thing. The lack of parameters here is frustrating because people do this all the time. The market's too high, the market this, the market that. I'm going to get out until it falls, then I'm going to get back in. And I find that to be, it's your money, do whatever you want. But I find that to be, I don't like it simply because you need to define parameters. Are you going to get back in if you're out if the market goes up? No, because you're in the same boat. Are you going to get back in if the market stays flat? I don't know. Probably not, because you're still in the same boat. You're literally, the market is up or flat. It's still where you were today thinking that the market is ready for a big dip. And then, unfortunately, you miss all the dividends. If the market goes down 20%, are you going to get back in then? I bet you won't, because you'd be like, I think it'd go down another 20%. I think it'd go down another 10%. I think you go down another 40, I think this could be it. We're dead. I don't like that at all. That parameter. I say 4 years of cash. I would wait. I mean, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I said in a video the other day. Ideally, within the last 2 years of retirement, you want to start devising a plan to have 4 years of cash at the go. So that way you don't have to spend money from your portfolio when it's down. But if you're still adding to it and you still got 5 years, I look, man, if you can't sleep at night, get out for sure. But don't, I'm not going to let you off the hook by saying I'm going to get back in because whatever. I've heard this 1,000 times in my career. And I always say, okay, you don't have any parameters. You're basically going to stay out. And then you're going to miss out on everything. You have FOMO, fear of missing out. And then you're going to say, I better get back in because I miss out on those gains. That's not good investing. That's bad investing. Now, if you can't sleep at night, get out. But don't say you're going to get back in, or you get out and dollar cost average back in. Just say, look, I'll just put, you know, 1% a month back in or something like that, if you can't sleep at night. But if it's just because we're speculating that we think the market is going to collapse, hell, we just had a 35% collapse. The way I look at it, that's the largest collapse we've ever had that quickly. If people can survive that, hell, they can pretty much survive anything. I was talking to these people the other day. I said, what'd you do in 2000 to 2003? Nothing. What'd you do 2007 to 2009? Nothing. What'd you do in 2020, February to March? Nothing. You're not getting out of the market. You're not gonna. If you were able to survive those times, the quickest, longest, fastest, most violent decline we've ever had in that short of time, if you can survive that, and then you survive the 3 years of March 2003, man, you can survive anything. Joe Biden, no malarkey. Does he still have that? Josh, what do you think of Transamerica and their products? Annuities are being transferred from Vanguard to them. Yeah, man, they got so many different products over there, James, I don't hate them. I just, they have a lot of products. So it depends on the product for sure. I get, at the end of the day, it just depends on the product. You got to go to Maine, one of our most beautiful states. Yes, ma'am. I'm not anti-Transamerica. I mean, they're all insurance companies, Northwestern Mutual, Mass Mutual, Transamerica, Prudential. Anytime there's an insurance product, it's going to cost you more for sure. But it might be value. Might be valued for sure. Depends on what you're trying to accomplish. Here it's in the U.S. is 0.2% from the latest stats. Shapiro had a good breakdown of the latest data for what it's worth. That, man, that's right on, man. Yeah, I don't watch Shapiro that much. The guy just got a nasally voice. I don't get why look, I don't have any qualm with Ben Shapiro. I just, the way he talks, I'm just like, it grinds on me a little bit. Just a nasally kind of voice. But hey, that's cool. But I'm a fan. Killer Cuomo and de Blasio should be in prison. I cannot agree more. Same with Nancy Pelosi, man. She was like, come to Chinatown. And then, calling Trump a racist for banning people from China. You can't argue with these people, man. They don't engage in logic. Right on, augured in. Right on. Great listening. Much obliged. There's science on both sides about masks. How dare you, Homer? How dare you? The science is settled. It's consensus. The science is settled. Anyone who doesn't believe what the science says is anti-science. Just ask science. And so I take my mic. Science, tell us what you think about masks. Oh, yeah, right. There is no science. There's scientism is what it is. People speaking on behalf of science as if they are all knowing. And the funny thing is, again, who was the mask research that was done up until this magic time and basically the beginning of April, end of March? All the previous research is just kaput. It's worthless. Fake news. Just weird. No one finds that odd. You'll never know true numbers on COVID. I completely agree, Patty. Completely agree. Yeah, Gary Coffey, Paul Coffey's brother, says, do you all know who Paul Coffey was? Today, I'm back to where I was before the crash because you stayed in, brother. You stayed in. Yeah, the only fellow really sick was 327, age 65, and only 80% lung capacity to begin with. From getting the flu 2 years ago, he went on a ventilator for 16 days in 2018. Man, right on, man. The age demographic who watches me is definitely higher than the most people on YouTube. This is why I'll never have the Graham Stephen numbers or anything like that, or the minority mindset. Because the bulk of YouTube people are not our age, if that makes sense. So they get huge numbers of views. Not as much watch time as I get, but huge numbers of views. I'll never have that because that's a different, you know, they're talking credit card stuff. And that's not my, it's just, you know, stimulus bill. Everyone wants to, you see all these bills on stimulus videos get tons of views. It's not my forte. It's really not my audience. It's just not. My audience is significantly older than those other guys for sure, which is cool by me, man. I'm saying a lot of what you said, and the immunity is permanent, for example, is not proven, is likely not true. I completely agree. Prairie Mark from Philippines, right? Curious on your thoughts on index versus mutual funds, lots of Dave Ramsey principles, Jack Bogle conversations. Yeah, I just buy the index without question, David. Now, look, I say that I'm writing a book, which is almost done, because my man Daniel provided me the spreadsheet from God's mouth itself. Literally, God gave this to David, Daniel in his brain. Daniel was able to produce it. It blows my crap away, that's for sure. And I had so much. You should see what I've been doing today, as a matter of fact. I got all this stuff. It's, oh my goodness, I cannot wait. It's literally, this has been a lifesaver for me. So it's like, oh, I gotta go back and revisit every spreadsheet. And my stuff was right. I didn't want to go back. And so using Daniel's stuff is just so much easier. And man, I can't wait, because it's gonna be awesome. It's gonna be awesome. But anyway, that's the Wellington Fund, an actively managed fund. It's actively managed. But I'm going to write a second follow-up to that on just S&P 500, because I think there's pros and cons of both. I tried twice. I got spanked. I was saying, once it falls to X, I'll buy 5 years later. I said, hell with it. I went in way higher. I would also be interested. Okay, we'll talk about that. Wealth is built by time in the market. I could not agree more, John. Wealth is built by time in the market. It's literally that simple. That study they show, everyone shows, you know, if you miss the top 10 days, you're basically getting the equivalent of CDs. Then people say, yeah, but if you miss the bottom 10 days, you're getting whatever. I say, but that's the issue. You can't time on either. I mean, that's the issue. You can't time on either side of that. You can't time on missing the bottom days. You can't time on missing the top. You just can't. It's insane to try. I mean, you know, you could sit here all day long and say, well, the future say it doesn't mean crap. And by the way, if you got mutual funds, you can't trade until after the close of business anyway. Seal, there we go. All right. Seal, he's back. All right. But you didn't say what you think the death rate is, my friend. What? Seal is not American. She's Canadian, Trudeau. Okay, I didn't know you're Canadian, Seely. So what's Trudeau doing? Oh, that's right. Trudeau is getting money to his family from charities. Trudeau is corrupt as the day is long. Isn't that funny? Anyway, I don't know what's going on in Canada, Seely, but in America, why would we need a national testing plan? Literally, what would that solve? I don't get it, man. I don't get what a testing plan would do. I mean... You have it or you don't. All right. So for the record, absolutely, I'm going to put you on the, do you want a contact tracing application on your phone? And if so, do you think we should all get it? And if so, what are the consequences that say, I'm not getting your damn contact tracing app on my phone? You're going to throw me in jail? You're going to tell me I can't go to the store? Where does this stuff stop, man? Just look at Victoria, Australia. What the hell is going on there? That's what we're looking at. That is what we're looking at. It's not going to happen. It's just, I will refuse. And I tell you, why not face shields, by the way? It gets in your eyes, man. It gets in your eyes. We've been saying that since day one. It gets in your eyes. Why not face shields? The logic of these people who are so scared of this is nuts to me. They're not mandating face shields, even though Birx and corrupt Fauci are talking about it. But I think that'll be the bridge too far. But I would have thought the mask, but I think the face shields will be the bridge too far. They're not mandating that. And if you really want to protect people, you got to have face shields. That's all there is to it. It's crazy. And again, I say protect people from what exactly? I that's what's the funny thing is at the end of the day, let's just go back to the ultimate mortality thing. And then they'll say, but this is always new too. Well, we have long-term problems. We don't know that. There's no, we have no evidence at all that there's long-term. How do we not know? Because it's only been around since November. We have no idea. This is all speculation. There's long-term stuff. I would simply say, well, that's the case. Well, goddamn, did I just say that? Well, pardon my French. The long-term effects of eating crap is a hell of a lot worse than the long-term effects of coronavirus. But we can see by all the heart rates, the dying people, heart rates, obesity, and all that. So we damn well better police up the food supply and start putting people in jail for selling us that crap, because that's a hell of a lot worse than the freaking commie virus. If we're worried about the long-term effects on the human body and people's dying and their inability to move and do things, we have a mass epidemic right now. So why are we not talking about that? Oh, because people can force it. They have a right to choose. Oh, so now we're back to right to choose, are we? It never stops with these people. Just look at Victoria and Australia. It's some scary, flipping crap down there. All right, so Celia, 1%, where are you getting that from? There's no point having a charity unless you get rich off it. Could not agree more. Meet Kevin has a lot of view subs. Yeah, he really hit the thing on the stimulus package. He hit that hard, and it, look, more power to him. I just, that bores me. I just don't know. Frankly, don't care that much. That's not my audience. It's just not. My audience is much older, probably wealthier, frankly, and more geared towards retirement than Meet Kevin. And partly, you know, Graham and Meet Kevin, there's another guy too. They're just young and they haven't been through the trenches the way I have. They've been through the trenches in their own capacity, real estate. I look, I'm not an expert by any stretch in real estate. It bores me. It's not something I want to do. And so I don't know that much about it, but I know financial planning. And so they have a different, you know, they have a different focus for sure. I like the minority mindset guy. I take issue with some of his stuff. Some of that is kind of elementary, frankly. And I do worry that there are, there is some pretty, not him so much, but there is some stuff that's not that great advice. Well, hell, I just talked about Carrie Pomegranate Schwab, who wrote that book, talk about Social Security, that you don't get your, anything that you put into Social Security before the age of 21 doesn't count for your average index monthly earnings. That's just bad. It's just bad stuff out there. And that does kind of concern me, but what's coming from young guys who haven't really been through much, who haven't seen much, who haven't really dealt with retirees. That bothers me, because I would hate to be the guinea pig off that fresh face guy, if that makes sense. And look, I'm not saying I got all the answers. Hells no, I don't. But I know a lot. And I'm not afraid to tell you, I don't know if I don't know. I just, like, I'm too old to care. Oh, you don't know about, when someone's asked me the other day about something, I said, I don't know. He said, you don't know about this? I said, no, why would I? He goes, you're a financial planner. I said, yeah. So find someone else who knows it. I don't care. I forgot what it was. I just, like, I don't know. That's okay. When you mentioned young for the cash value, I have three kids. Well, you ain't young then, Ellie. If you got three kids, they're 28, 30, and 33. Are they too? Okay, gotcha. So you're thinking about buying it for them. Yeah, why not just buy Roth IRAs? What's the point? I mean, you know, remember, the whole thing about life insurance is literally if someone dies, it goes to somebody else tax-free for some reason. You see what I'm saying? So remember, your life insurance isn't there to benefit the insured. It's just not. And anytime you're mixing investments with life insurance, inherently you're getting worse of both. All right. And the reason for that is simply because you're getting investments that are there for the insured, but they have to pay a fee in which the life insurance can benefit the insured. I know that doesn't make sense, but you know, you're kind of combining two completely different products into one, making it fit. And it's just not a good mix, because the life insurance is there to provide a death benefit for when the insured dies. In this case, it'd be your kids. The investments are there to provide ideally a retirement plan or some kind of income spending for when someone needs the money. Two completely different scenarios. And when you combine the two, inherently both are going to be in not as efficient as just doing it each and individually. Buy term and invest the rest. What I would suggest you, screw the life insurance. I'd say, if you want the kids being short, you just buy term. Hell, get a 30-year term for 28, 30, 33 people, $50 a month, easy peasy. And then you say, okay, guys, for the rest, I'll put $5,000 a year into a Roth IRA for you. That's the way to do it. You're not going to beat that. I'm telling you, you're not going to beat it. Don't do cash value life insurance for your kids. No way. My kids, I took out when they're in, all in diapers, you know, in 20 years. So by 20, when they hit 20, I guess I took Maddie's out when she's seven. So when Maddie's 20, no, I think 25. Anyway, probably less than 8 years. Eight years or so, they should all be paid up or pretty close to it. And then what I'm going to do, Ellie, is when they hit, when they graduate, I'm just going to give it to them. And they can cash it out. They can keep it. They can do whatever they want. But when they graduate school or go in the military or something like that, or some point, I'll just give it to them. Yeah, no, I agree, Homer, about Graham, 100%. Yeah, it was my man Dan, right on, Dan. That's my man Daniel right there, the spreadsheet guru. Is there a fun exclusive tech stocks in NASDAQ in the Qs, the QQQ, or I guess the quadruple Qs now? I think so. I'm sure there are. Humans are not equipped with clairvoyance. If you would have asked me yesterday what clairvoyance was, I would not have known. But just today, my wife and I were talking about it. She goes, yeah, that's pretty clairvoyant. I said, what the hell does that mean? And she goes, your forward ability to see things, a forward looking. I said, ooh. So now I know what clairvoyance was, John. So you notice I said that as if I knew what it was. But if you would have asked me yesterday, I would have said, yeah, we're not equipped with clairvoyance. Yeah. And then I would have gone on to the next comment. All right. There's no point out of charity. Yeah, right on. We talked about that. I'm not sure the insurance sale would sell it to you anyway. If you go to cash, you're losing money. That's okay. Gotcha. All right. Grant Cardone going bankrupt should tell you something about gambling with real estate. Did Grant Cardone go bankrupt? Damn. Josh must have had a Red Bull before the stream. Nah, man. I just love talking finance. There's a Gary Coffee, man. We got Gary Coffee and another Paul Coffee's brother. My daughter had the swine flu, the H1N1. Wait, H1N1? She had the swine flu. It was bad, too. It was bad. Remember, many children died from that, and no one cared. Hey, Sam Whiskey, can you receive Social Security for retire overseas? Absolutely. Unless you live in some of those, I think, Iran, Cuba, and maybe Venezuela. Absolutely, Sam. Much obliged for the super chat. Herd immunity is slowly happening. Yep. What national plan of any sort has value? The Eisenhower Roads, Mike. The Eisenhower Roads, that's what they always say. The Eisenhower Road system, that's the national plan that had value. They always say that. I'm like, of all the national plans, that's the one? Okay. And we can argue that too, because once we had the Eisenhower Roads, that led to the escape to the suburbs. Hey, man. Celia, you're welcome on this channel anytime you want. You're a good person. I don't care what they say. And just because we disagree, I like the fact that you got staying power to fight back and say what you think. Much obliged you being here, for sure. The last thing we want is boring. I mean, look, man, at the end of the day, I like when people bring the issue from what they're seeing. I hate the ad hominem, I do. And I probably engage in that with Dr. Fauci. I get it. So I'm a hypocrite. You know? When I see Dr. Fauci in charge of the national, this is where I'm so disappointed. I had two things I'm disappointed with Trump. Allowing Dr. Fauci to take charge. He should have canned that guy a long time ago. And then on top of that, not going balls breaker on busting up the monopolies in tech. There's some evil crap happening there. And this is what George W. Bush didn't do either when it came to Katrina. And after that, with the rest of the Iraq war, he just took it on his chin. He just took it. He took it. It wasn't him taking it, though. It's his supporters that were taking it. Bush was immune to that. Yeah, he got called all the evil names in the book, but it was his supporters that were taking it. And the same thing times 10 has happened with Trump. And Trump needs to take it to these people, man. He needs to take it to these people and tell them this. No, we're not letting you do this to people anymore. We're not letting you beat up women because they want to vote for me. We're not letting you freaking fire people because they want to vote for me. And they said something on some freaking social media that said they supported Trump. I get it. We're at right to work or at work, at will. I get all that. I don't know how you deal with that, but you make a freaking national issue out of this that we're not sitting back and allowing you to abuse my supporters the way George W. Bush allowed his supporters to be abused. I'm sick of this crap. And Trump needs to get out there and start saying it. Now, look, at the end of the day, I'm going to vote for the guy, bar none. And I mean, just there's no other, because there's no alternative, frankly, there's not. But he needs to, enough of, look, I don't have any qualm with his Twitter stuff, but the dude's addicted to it. And if he's going to use that Twitter stuff, freaking make it so you're, I mean, we get it. The media is the evil, the enemy of the people, I get it. But start saying stuff, how you're going to fix stuff to say, put these people on their heels for once. Like I said last night's live stream. They got the ball first and goal at the 1 yard line. They got Marshawn Lynch in the backfield. They got Russell Williams at quarterback, and they don't have Pete Carroll as the coach. And we don't have anyone on the field. And we need to get some friggin' fear in the left to say these people aren't going to take this anymore, man. And Trump has done okay, but he needs to be better at it to say enough of the stupid stuff with Joe Scarborough. What the hell was that? It was a couple months ago. I was like, oh God, I could care two craps about Joe Scarborough. No one watches Joe Scarborough. He's an idiot. You know, don't lower yourself to these people. Fight the problems that are out there, man. And that's my biggest frustration. With that said, I still unequivocally support the man without question. I'm not getting my hopes up about this Durham thing, by the way. Everyone's like, Durham's going to come out and we're going to indict all these people. I don't think so. We thought that about the other guy. It ain't going to happen. All right, my friends, I'm going to get on out of here. Much obliged to see y'all here. Do you think we'll see a 3% treasury in the next 3 years? Niet, as us people who listen to Putin tell us who to vote for say, niet. I do not think so. No way. Don't see it. Appreciate y'all being here. Again, I just want to jump on and answer some questions. So thanks again. Appreciate y'all being here. And I appreciate the dialogue. We'll see you guys. I'm going to try to do it again on Wednesday. I'm going to try to do one. I guess I can't do it Wednesday afternoon. But we'll see you guys. We are not shutting down again. Yeah, right on, man. We shall see. If Fauci tells us to shut down, apparently we're going to shut down. Because Fauci rolls. See you guys.